when I read about open works, I know I do see the term that was unfamiliar to me, maker spaces. And if that's a buzzword or definition, can you describe, because with open works, you come up with this has the access to infrastructure of production and maker spaces, has an incredible potential to open up economic opportunities for people in the city. Describe what a maker space is and how you see that helping to open up these economic opportunities, especially in some of the neighborhoods here in Baltimore that really need those opportunities.
Sure, and I think some of what I'm going to talk about touches on what Anita and Richard were speaking to earlier. So in some ways, makerspaces are a very Marxian ideal. We're putting the means of production directly back in the hands of the people, right? But over the last 10 or 15 years, as these spaces have sprouted up around the country and around the world, that has tended to be in kind of a hobbyist lens, or a lens of people who already knew what they were doing, already had a degree, were an engineer or something, and were already wealthy and could do this with their disposable time and income. And part of that has to do with a scale of space and a scale of infrastructure available in the space, right? So if you get a couple folks together, a 3D printer, some hand tools, you're limited in what you can actually make, right? And so we are now one of the largest maker spaces in the country, and these spaces have steadily been expanding in scale over the last couple years in particular. And what that opens up is a whole new opportunity economic development-wise. We have three full-size CNC routers, which can machine a piece of plywood, right? So you can make a piece of furniture in 45 minutes that might have used to take a day. And then we can have, well, you know, we're open 12 hours a day times three machines times however many members can access it during those hours, right? And that turns into real money for real makers. I would say our audience is split kind of amongst our membership. Maybe 50% full or nearly full-time makers, be it in the art world or the industrial design or architecture, whatever it may be, and then sort of 50% on the hobbyist side. And this reflects trends that are happening in the workforce in general, where close to a quarter of the workforce now is a freelancer or contractual worker. Many of our technicians, some of whom worked installing this project and 3D printing those busts in our facility, patched together a bunch of different small jobs to kind of add up to one full-time income. I'm not necessarily advocating for this one way or the other. I'm just saying it is sort of the reality of work today, and we can be a flexible platform that's low cost, that's accessible, that allows people to shed some of the sunk costs of equipment and studio space and focus on what they're good at, which is making stuff. And then on sort of the digital divide side, the long-term vision for open works, really on a 10-year horizon, is that the 10 and 12-year-old kids that are coming into our free Saturday programming and our free after-school programming, where the teens are coming from Baltimore Design School, can then link up with some of our collaborators like CCBC, like Coppin State University, like MICA, find a path to either meaningful trade skills or meaningful education. And then when they graduate and come out of those programs, they can rejoin us to launch their entrepreneurial idea, meet a new collaborator or friend, or come back and start a nonprofit to serve their community.
Are there any specific projects Open Works is working with other organizations that you would want to talk about?
Yes, so we have a couple of exciting things happening right now. One thing I want to touch on, it's fresh in my mind because I had a meeting about it today, is we have a partnership in place with Coppin State University College of Business, and it's the first partnership between a makerspace and an HBCU in the country. Makerspace have traditionally been seen as space full of a lot of people that look like me. And given the makeup of Baltimore City, we thought it was important to start to really push against the notion of what these spaces can and should be. So we pursue a relationship with Coppin. They will be opening a small business center next month within our space to both study small business formation and entrepreneurship inside Open Works, and in the three neighborhoods surrounding Open Works, Greenmount West, Johnson Square, and Barclay. They've been doing this type of work around their campus, where they go on community walks and gather kind of qualitative data from both the barber shops and the dry cleaners and the chicken boxes and kind of the small-scale formal businesses, as well as the gray market economy, the shade tree mechanics, the women watching children in their backyard or cooking food out of the back of their house, and painting a much fuller and richer picture of what work and economic development looks like in Baltimore City than sort of the Bureau of Labor Statistics kind of official portrait of what's going on in town.
Deepak, I'm not sure we would be here without you or your firm, bringing life back to this part of Howard Street. I have to say that I always knew that state offices were in this part of Hutzler's over here, but I wasn't sure what was next door and what was in that building. Do you want to discuss a little bit about your firm and what goes on at that corner of Howard and Lexington Street?
Oh, sure. So, whether you know it or not, the building at the Hutzler's Inn is attached to what we call the Tower Building. So this is the palace, for the reasons discussed. And the neighboring building is called the Tower. It was burned down in the 80s.
83, yes.
And it was rebuilt as a high-tech building next to Lexington, it's basically between here and Lexington Market. And for various reasons, geography and others, it is actually the largest telecommunications hub in the state and one of the largest in the Northeast. So almost all communications going from Northern Virginia to New York to Europe go through that building, under us, through it, and your 911 calls and all sorts of things. So that's, AI, that's principal interest in why we acquired it and why I've taken such an interest in this space. And I'm just gonna totally pivot on that question.
Well, I mean, I guess what I also would wanna know is, what would your firm, considering all the technical capabilities that you have and what goes on in that building next door, what can it offer to help rehabilitate or reinvent this Howard Street area and beyond in the city of Baltimore?
So that's really exciting for me. So technology is incredibly transformative and disruptive. And I'm going to borrow from all of you guys because you guys are great. Baltimore was a port city and then an industrial city, and then things changed and disrupted all of that. And Baltimore's been working to find a new vision of itself. And so our concept of future cities is, right, collaboration between all of the stakeholders, the residents, and industry and government to figure that out. And technology, again, is disruptive, but it is also collaborative. And getting the means of production into people's hands and getting that publicized on the web or elsewhere, that's stuff that we can do and that's what we can help with, right? Helping redefine the dignity of work, whether it's you have five jobs, but all of a sudden you're in charge of yourself as a contractor instead of having five or 10 different bosses, right? There's dignity in that. And taking spaces that had lost their purpose and finding new ways of activating that space and using it and collaborating with folks that aren't necessarily the first people you think of is incredibly exciting. One of the things that we are doing in collaboration with Rick's team and Kirby's and others is we are about to announce, so don't tell anybody, a free, as in breathing, Wi-Fi project for the city of Baltimore. We're going to start around here, and it's going to work its way out. And our vision, and this is borrowing the idea of silos and everything else, is that internet has been allowed to silo us, even the digital halves, into I have internet in my apartment or my condo, but I don't have it in my elevator. I don't have it on the light rail, but I have it at Starbucks. And so the experiences we have get broken up by our phone reconnecting to a different network. All of that is obsolete. Okay, that has no place in a future city. You should have a seamless experience walking from your front door to your buddies, to your Starbucks, to work and back, And you shouldn't think about the technology. It should just be there. And lots of people have tried various versions of that, and they're not any successful projects that I'm aware of. And that's a shame. So we're going to start. We're going to pilot this out, and we're working with folks who know, the folks we're going to be touching, to see how we can make the digital divide shrink, maybe disappear, provide better access to education, not just in the charter schools, but even in those families, and see if we can empower better access to the dignity of work through technology, not by disrupting it, by collaborating and empowering it.
Now, clearly, Baltimore is made up more than just these six organizations represented on this panel. I kind of want to know, going down the road, start with Dina, is there an organization on the panel that you feel the contemporary would be able to partner with in an exciting new way that's just kind of out of the box?
I think we've partnered with everybody on the panel.
I know, that's what I'm wondering. Well, is there any organization that you think the contemporary would be out of the box that's not here that you would want to? Any type? I mean, what would you, considering how you're based on open spaces, what would be the best way, or what would be an interesting way to further the mission of your organization and reach people?
I think it would be interesting to get more involved in city government. I don't know what that looks like. Mm-hmm. I think that there should be more opportunities between what is happening in the arts and cultural sector and city government. And I think that artists see things in interesting ways and convene people naturally in ways that it feels like lots of folks in city government are trying and are doing so unsuccessfully. And so I wish that there was a way that the contemporary could work. Let me not say anything while I'm like leaving in 3 weeks, but I think that there should be a little bit more interest at a legislative, city, even maybe state level with what things like the contemporary work on a daily basis, especially now, like while there are so many conversations at a federal level about continuing to defund arts, culture, humanities, public broadcast. I think that it will be a dark day for the nation and that cities and states will have to pick up the slack, and I think it starts with at least putting those bodies in the room, and not enough of that, I guess, happens. So I think that that's important.
Kirby, I'm curious, technology, increasing, I mean, there seemed to be a lot of excitement and interest in the room. You mentioned about wiring the whole city of Baltimore. How do you see that changing the face of downtown, especially in this area per se, bringing technology there? I'm just kind of interested to hear your point of view.
Well, it's incredibly important. A few years ago, we provided free Wi-Fi in public spaces like Center Plaza, Hopkins Plaza, at Pratt & Light, but we just didn't have the resources to do it more broadly. So we think it's very important for people to get free access to the internet whenever they can. And it ties not just into technology, but it's also everything that happens in downtown. Downtown is unusual because everybody in the city touches it at one point in a year, whether they're passing through, even if it's just jury duty, but somehow they connect to downtown Baltimore. And so how do you draw people into the opportunity here? So you do it through eliminating the digital divide, but it's also some of the physical divides, and even some of the great amenities we have. One thing we just kicked off was a subsidy for the new bike share system. I know there's a bike share station right up here. It costs $15 a month to ride, which is not terrible for most people, but we are subsidizing now for people who, through the SNAP program, show that they have need. Now we will subsidize, so it's $3 a month as opposed to $15. So it's those types of things that we want to do to help connect people together. But it's also important to add more affordable housing, because we're talking about these divides. Just a block up from here, we should check out Mulberry at Park, which is an enterprise project. There's 68 affordable units, brand new, gorgeous, very spacious units there. And there's more affordable housing projects happening within two or three blocks coming soon. So it's not just the digital divide, but the physical divide as well. But touching on the physical divide, Deepak talked about connecting us all together digitally and connecting the blocks together physically is what we need to do. Even if it's through lighting, if it's through improving the streetscape, we've got to make it easier to walk through our downtown and through our entire city.
Anita, I mean, museums. The history, the knowledge you have, it seems to be a real impetus to bring that into a digitized format, whether it's just for locals or for people across the world to learn more about your museum and more about what you offer. Can you talk about how technology affects your museum, affects any museum, and how it can better its position here in the city, and who you can help partner with in order to promote your mission? Anything along those lines?
Yeah. So let's see. Technology can do any number of things for museums, but one thing that I'm particularly interested in and that we've been exploring is in helping people encounter our collections in a different way. So we've been partnering with a firm called Direct Dimensions, which is a large-scale laser industrial scanning firm that is doing some really groundbreaking work here in Maryland. And one thing that they're doing many things for us, but one thing that they're doing is we have, those of you who have been to the museum, you've seen that big shipyard crane that marks our entrance. And it needs a facelift, so we've mounted a campaign to restore it. But people come and they see the crane, they get very excited about it, and the principal of Direct Dimensions, who I met through Will, incidentally, at an Open Works event, came down, fell in love with the crane, said, "I'm going to scan that crane." So that's great, you know, we have the digital files, which helps with engineering and, you know, paint specs and all of that, but what he's been able to do is to create a 3D file that is now printing inside the museum. So when you come into the museum, you see a little 3D crane printing on a 3D printer that is created by a Maryland startup. And then he's also working with us on creating animated manipulations of the crane that, you know, can be moved around and can go online. So that's just why, I mean, there are many, many ways that technology can help us do what we do. But for us, that's a significant partnership because it not only helps people understand better what's in our collection, in this case the crane he's doing with other things, but also provide some visibility for a Maryland company that's doing some really interesting groundbreaking work with 3D technology.
Are there any